All right, well, welcome everybody. Thank you for coming. As you all know, it's the centennial year for the Forest Preserve District, and for the last year and a half or so, we've been doing a lot of research getting ready for that, and in the last 7 months, or 7 months?
7 weeks.
7 weeks. We've been doing even more research and finding a lot of really cool stuff, and that's kind of what we want to share with you. So some of this will be information you've heard before as far as the early years of the Forest Preserve, but some of it is new material that we've gotten just in the recent weeks of research, and some really great photographs of what are now Forest Preserve properties that we want to share. For those of you who don't know, my name is Chris Gingrich. I'm in the Office of Community Services and Education. This is Brian Failing, who's been interning our seasonal with us this summer. And we're going to talk about the early years just prior to the Forest Preserve's establishment and the early years of the Forest Preserve and how we got to kind of where we are today. And I guess some of the main themes we kind of want to emphasize are that this didn't happen in a vacuum. The Forest Preserve was not established in 1915 out of nowhere. There was an entire conservation movement that had been growing in the United States and locally. There are some major early voices in the conservation movement in the Chicago area that are part of helping establish the Forest Preserves. So we're going to talk about them. We want to talk a little bit about the development of the Forest Preserves, you know, as a statewide movement, and some of the organizations that then pushed and helped us get Forest Preserves here in DuPage County. And Brian and I will be kind of jumping back and forth as we go through the presentation today.
All right, so we could spend all day talking about all the different people who were involved in this movement, kind of setting the tone for the theory that landscape architects and those involved in the parks movement were learning when they went to school. So just to touch on a handful of these individuals, Andrew Jackson Downing, he's an American horticulturalist and landscape designer. And he's most known for style guides that he put together for the way that homes should be laid out and designed. He was an advocate for the large inner city parks, so things like Central Park. He actually put in a design, his firm put in a design for that park, but unfortunately Olmsted was the design that they chose. Some consider Downing to be the father of American landscape architecture. But more commonly, people associate that with Olmsted. But with his plans that he put together in his books for, you know, homes, the architecture, and the landscape, he mixed aspects of romantic architecture with the pastoral, picturesque architecture of the English countryside. So you take that and then think about what we're going to talk about with what becomes known as the prairie style. This is just an earlier, you know, iteration of that, and seeing how that developed into that. So O.C. Simmons, another individual, he was a prolific writer, so we have a lot of his stuff left today that we can go back and reference and learning about landscape architecture. He's most known for his work at Graceland Cemetery and then the Morton Arboretum here in Lisle. So he did designs for everything from cemeteries and estates to parks and campus designs. Wilhelm Miller was a professor at the University of Illinois in Champaign. He wrote a lot on landscape gardening and was one of the first individuals to come up with this idea of the prairie style. In 1915, he published The Prairie Spirit in Landscape Gardening. And in that, he talks about the prairie spirit. And you may ask yourself, what is the prairie spirit? And so to sum up this, it's about a 50-page booklet, but to sum it up in just a few key points, the designs are based on the scenery that was originally found here and not copied from other regions. So looking at the distinct plants and trees that are from the Illinois region. And then restore and recreate this local scenery and repetition. So if you've been to St. James Farm, the alley of trees, you know, this idea of not just one tree here, one tree there, but a repetition of design. One thing that was written in this booklet is that the prairie spirit and the prairie style fulfills man's need to have a, you know, life that is equal between, you know, living and nature. And so I feel the uplifting influence of the rich rolling prairie and will bring its spirit into my daily life. I will do what I can to promote the prosperity, happiness, and beauty of all prairie.
And if I can just jump in there real quick, So what you see happening here is there was a conservation movement, and kind of our tagline for the Centennial has been connecting people to nature for 100 years. And this has been going on for even longer than that. If you think back to Henry David Thoreau and, you know, the early parks movement for national parks and setting aside forest land was already taking place. There's some great online exhibits about people who visited Niagara Falls, and there was a guest book, and so people even in the mid-1800s signing that guest book. So there was this desire to connect to nature, and that was a nationwide movement, and then was taking place even here locally, including trying to focus on the prairie style, which would be more the native landscape.
So really bringing this, you know, close to home. Jensen, arguably the most well-known landscape architect for prairie style, designed a lot of parks and private estates throughout the region, not just Illinois. Locally, he would be known for Lalatia Park in Lombard, but he was one of the early founders of the Prairie Club of Chicago and Friends of Our Native Landscape, two groups that we'll talk about shortly. And then just a few other people. Mae Watts, she was involved with the founding of the Illinois Prairie Path and the first rail to trails conversion. And she worked at the Morton Arboretum as an ecologist and naturalist for over 20 years. And then Chauncey Stevens Hill.
Show of hands, who's heard of Chauncey Hill or Chance Hill? Okay. Very important to the forest preserve, so you'll learn a lot about him.
I know his granddaughter.
So he was a landscape architect, and he was working and practicing the same time as Jensen. He was from Urbana-Champaign. He went to U of I, got his BS in floriculture in 1914, and he taught there from 1918-1922. And then at that point, he went into private practice and started doing a lot of commissions for universities across the state, both public and private, including North Central College in Naperville, and closer to home, the Forest Preserve District, and doing work in nearly a dozen of our preserves between the 1920s and 40s. And he was also the supervising landscape architect for the state of Illinois under C. Herrick Hammond.
Was he an employee?
He was actually hired by the district, yeah. So he was paid directly by the district to work with the Civilian Conservation Corps camps and manage the designs of the preserves that the CCC was working on. So you'll see his name on all the blueprints. If you go out to the preserves where there's buildings, like shelters and things constructed by the CCC, on those bronze plaques where it lists all the commissioners from the time and Board of Supervisors, his name is listed as the landscape architect for those projects.
So you'll see at Fullersburg and on the boathouse, McDowell on the picnic shelter, the McKee House. And then just so we're not here all day, just some other people who would have also been involved in this movement, both for conservation and for the developing of prairie style. Olmsted in the City Parks movement, Burnham, City Beautiful in the Plan of Chicago 1909, calling for regional and city parks. Ebenezer Howard, many of you probably haven't heard of him, but he was another individual talking about, you know, the parks movement and making these city parks. Frank Lloyd Wright, landscape architect. Henry Cowles, professor at the University of Chicago. Aldo Leopold was involved with the parks movement up in Wisconsin and also did a plan with Chance Hill in Iowa, and Lewis Mumford as well. So now to shift more specifically to creating forest preserves in Illinois. Again, this coincides with a bunch of other movements going on at the time. The Prairie Club of Chicago developed out of the playground movement that Jane Addams started, and concerns with city life and the evils that were there. They already talked a little bit about Plan of Chicago. And then 1913, we see the passage of the Downstate Forest Act. If you want to touch a little more.
So again, what you're seeing here is this combination of the parks movement, conservation, prairie style landscape architecture all coming together to kind of lead to this effort to create the forest preserve. And we've actually already done a conservationist article on that and a blog post on that. So there were actually several efforts to get a Downstate Forest Preserve Act passed. And on the third try, they finally got it to succeed. And then Cook County was the first county to actually go to referendum and create a forest preserve district. And then DuPage County followed the following year. And And there were a lot of different groups and organizations that were involved in that. And turn it back over to Brian real quick for an overview of some of these.
So the first one that we've really looked into is the Prairie Club of Chicago. They were created in 1908, and again, a lot of these individuals that names will look familiar. Some that I've already talked about, Stephen Mather, who went on to be the first director of the National Park Service, and Laredo Taft. The organization was known for their organized hikes into what they called the country. They wanted to help people escape the crowded inner city of Chicago and the ugliness of industry. And this time, so very early on in the creation of this organization, Jensen became involved, and this idea of being outdoors and focusing on conservation was key to the organization. And so one thing that they did were these weekly hikes into the country. They went to areas that they found to be natural in the country and embodied the picturesque, the untouched by man kind of environment. And what they would do is they would send out teams of people months in advance to different towns throughout Cook, DuPage, Will, and other counties in the state to find these places that you could walk to, that they could do their nature hikes. They did anywhere from 5 to 15 miles on a Saturday. They'd take the train from Chicago, get off Lyle, Naperville, Elmhurst, Warrenville, anywhere, and go for a hike. And so we actually took a trip to their archives. They're in Chesterton, Indiana, at the Westchester Township Historical Museum. And they have scrapbooks of their walks. In addition to that, they have the newsletters that went out to members listing what walk would be on what day. So the pictures we have, almost all of them we've been able to match up to a description of what path they followed. And so we're going to show you a bunch of pictures of walks that were through DuPage County, and many of them are in areas that would later go on to become preserves that we know today. It's hard to pinpoint exactly where all of them are, but some of them it's pretty clear where they were. So one of their very early walks, 1908, along Salt Creek. Salt Creek was one of their favorite spots to go, it seems. At one point or another, they were doing a walk to Salt Creek maybe twice a month or once every 2 months. Like, they were going there all the time. And so this shows the old mill, Growy Mill, early 1900s, before a lot of restoration had been done. Actually, no restoration at that point.
Yeah, this is before any work had been done to restore the mill at all. So just referred to as the old mill. One thing before we move on, too, is, again, think about the time period here. You're looking at 1908. So these are late Victorian folks that are going on hikes, similar to the hikes that we lead today, except you've got to remember they're wearing the clothing of the Victorian era, and they're hiking through preserves or areas that have not been built up as preserves, so no facilities. And these are hardy folks. When you read the descriptions of their walks, we see things like they're going to take a train from Chicago, arrive in Winfield, they're going to hike out through what was called DuPage Woods, follow the DuPage River south to Warrenville, get back on a train, and then head back into Chicago. So we actually had talked early on as part of a centennial project, maybe taking one of these walks and recreating it, but I'm not sure if we'd get many people in 2015. I'm not sure I want to take a hike in 2015. But these were hardy folks, and you'll see as the photos go through, they actually got a big crowd out for these things. And one of Jensen's reasons for doing this was how he encouraged that love of nature and used that to push the passage of the forest preserves. So this was a not only recreational and connecting with nature, but was actually part of his publicity campaign to get people to support the forest preserves.
So it's another view looking upstream from the ice house on Salt Creek.
And if you go to Fullersburg today, there is a marker showing where that ice house was, so you kind of get an idea of where that was.
And then we have other pictures to show just the amount of people that would come out for these walks, but you can see walking along the banks of Salt Creek, just how many people there were. And another view of the mill and the original dam that was there before the CCC came in.
Which dam number was that? Was it 8 or 9 or 10?
Yeah, I don't know which dam it would be, but
looks like it's about in the right spot, because I know it's been moved a couple times, so it It looks where it should be.
And like most dams, they have a history of washing out periodically, so.
Yep.
And just here's a, you know, how many people. They're, you know, filling up the whole sidewalk for a few lots, and they're going 3x3 down the sidewalk.
Perfectly dressed for a, you know, 12
So who wants to help us recreate this? Anyone? Bob?
Yeah. I got the hat. That's about the only part I can recreate.
I hear Klein Creek will let us borrow costumes. And then additional pictures of Salt Creek. And recreational use of the creek near the dam goes back, you know, long before the Forest Preserve came in and started renting boats out of the boathouse.
The Fullersburg Boathouse would have been built in the 1930s. That building that's now the Nature Center was originally for renting out boats and a warming house for ice skating. But we found these photos that there was actually boat rentals going on near Browning Mill.
Is that the mill in the distance?
Yes, it is.
That's the mill in the background. They even would do hikes in the wintertime, and they actually encouraged their members to bring ice skates so that if the rivers were frozen, that would be part of the hike, is skating down the river.
Yeah. And they would bring their lunch and pop a squat where the tree cover is nice and eat their lunch. And another picture of them out, you know, on Salt Creek in the boats.
No, I think the shoreline has kind of receded a little bit from where it was. Yeah.
Well, this would be just above the dam, so yeah. You would have a mill pond effect there. So.
Gibson Mill.
Jumping down from higher ground to lower ground.
Very athletic for the
Gibson Girl.
Yeah, very much like a Gibson Girl. Yeah.
And so here a nice image showing, you know, where the boats would have been and the boats that they're renting out. It looks like they're about to fall in. And again, just walking along Salt Creek. The cows.
Intended cows on Salt Creek. We gotta bring those back.
Again, just sitting there eating lunches.
And typically what they would do is they would send out an advance team for the club to go out a couple weeks in advance of the walk or even a little bit longer than that. And they would, you got to remember at this time, this was not public land. This was not Forest Preserve yet. These were privately owned farms. And they would go to each farm that they were going to cross in their walk, and they would get permission to, you know, cross a pasture or to stop and eat a, you know, have a picnic in somebody's grove, or even take down fence boards and cross through. Great photos of them trying to climb over fences and under fences in their dresses and suit coats. And
lift up the barbed wire. And then just to change preserves, Warrenville Grove, showing the rock dam that was there.
And this would actually be the dam that was for the mill that used to be there. This is not the Civilian Conservation Corps dam. The Civilian Conservation Corps actually tore this dam out to build their dam, which since has been torn out. So it's kind of a progression. So this is the original dam from when there was a mill there. This dam was actually, if I remember the maps right, a little above, upstream from where the CCC built their dam.
Okay, but so below, like where those islands were?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, I'm just looking at
so the mill race that's still there, this would have been the dam that fed water into that mill race.
Yeah, just seeing how there's so few trees, that's what's right over there.
Yeah. A lot of land that was probably cultivated and used as pasture land and hay fields.
And then one of the interesting things we found was reference to a spring in DuPage Woods. So that'd be now West DuPage Woods. And you look at a modern day map, there's no spring. We were asking around, no one knew of any spring there, but we did find a map from the 40s that showed the spring. And we superimposed it on a modern day aerial. So you can see the parking lot was on there, the baseball diamond. The map did not have the trails, so we placed it, if the map's accurate, where it should be. Chris and I actually went out there to find it last week, and all the growth was about up to here. Chris went in, I stood on the trail. And
so he is not allowed to be a member of the Prairie Club.
I wasn't dressed appropriately.
But Dan Whedon did this for us using the GIS software, so Come later on in the season when the foliage is down a little bit.
And the mosquitoes.
Out there and see if there's any remnant of it. if not the spring itself, the spring may have dried up, you know, since then.
But hopefully
the horses may have even covered it in the intervening years. But
hopefully the rock ring is still there. Just another one just showing, they're walking through the woods. We'd love to think that that's Jens Jensen on the right. Sort of looks like him, or maybe a Charlie Chaplin figure. Walking up from the spring.
And given the frequency of their walks out here over the years, there's no doubt that Jens Jensen hiked through what is now DuPage County Forest Preserve land. That's assured.
And just to reiterate, this is their recreation.
Yep. And crossing the DuPage River on stepping stones. And in the description for the walk, it also mentions the spring. So they would have crossed this, you know, crossed DuPage River sometime before or after they hit the spring on their way down into Warrenville. And then just another preserve, we found a few images of what is now Herrick Lake, then called Lily Lake, on a trip they took to Wheaton. And then our favorite, one of our other favorites, is this giant boulder. And we had no idea where it was. We then later found out it's in the Morton Arboretum, not Forest Preserve property, but in their booklet they mentioned that 17 people could stand up on the rock and take photographs. So these are a few that we found in the collection. Any good historian. So.
The person on the left looks very familiar.
I found my doppelganger from 8.
Yeah. They even had patches back then.
Yeah.
But another image of that, so this would have been sometime between 1912 and 1921 on a walk from Lyle to Belmont. If you read the descriptions, they were coming into Lyle, following the old Indian trail through the Arboretum, through what is now Hidden Lake. Mentions crossing the bridge, which may be the one bridge that's there now in Hidden Lake, near where the mill, Barney's Mill, would have been. Some of their walks mention that there was a mill. Mentions walking through Arthur Cutton's property, getting a tour of the grounds from one of the directors of the site, and then walking on to Butterfield. So they were walking through Hidden Lake before it was Hidden Lake. So that takes us to the second organization. And we found out about Friends of Our Native Landscape when talking with the curator from the archive for the Prairie Club. And she's like, have you looked into this organization? So I type it in on Google and I come across their yearbook from 1914, listing, you know, why it was created, what they do, and the original members. And I'm sitting there with Chris and I go, I wonder. He's like, I bet you Chance Hill's a member. Sure enough, on the membership list, there's Chance Hill. So this is 1914 that this was created, the year Hill graduated from University of Illinois. And the purpose of this organization was twofold. The cultivation in every individual of a more active pleasure in the world of the open, and the preservation for the people of today and for all future generations of examples of the native landscape types that are fast disappearing before the encroachment of industry.
That's a mission that sounds familiar, doesn't it? Just slightly.
And so they have a long list of goals and what they hope to accomplish, and they want to preserve the native landscape. You know, this everything that was talked about by Wilhelm Miller. To spread information on their park and forest policy in Illinois, which actually a lot of what they were advocating for did come to fruition. Starved Rock, working with the Prairie Club for the Indiana Dunes. What's the one in Rock Island where Black Hawk is?
Black
State
Park?
White Pines, right?
White Pines, yeah, White Pines. So, you know, all these parks that they wanted really did come true. They prepared a map of these areas and they took out a full page in the Chicago Tribune. And they were advocates for a state park system for Illinois, as well as a preserve district for every county in the state. Obviously, that didn't happen, but They did take walks through Cook, they took walks through DuPage and Will counties. All three have forest preserves. And so that's pretty remarkable. And their work carried on throughout other states. Michigan had a Friends of Our Native Landscape chapter, Indiana, Wisconsin, and a few others we've come across.
And interestingly, as we were looking through at the Prairie Club of Chicago's archives, we find some photographs of their walks in like 1914, early 1915, where they would say they were in DuPage County, and then in parentheses, no forest preserve yet. So they were working on it.
So I think it was a 1914
Cook County had already gotten there, and they were working on DuPage County.
So just a few of the members, again, a lot of these people we've talked about, names look familiar, but just other locals were involved and prominent members. So Mr. Avery Coonley, Coonley School, Coonley Residence, Mrs. Glessner, her and her husband lived Prairie Avenue in Chicago, and she was involved. Chance Hill, Jens Jensen, Professor Wilhelm Miller, and Dwight Perkins. And so they were advocates as well for outdoor education, so it's no different than today, the No Child Left Inside initiatives and getting children and families outside to interact with nature. They describe parks as playgrounds of the people, and that's actually what they titled the map that they put in the Chicago Tribune. One of the other interesting things about the organization is they had Kenneth Sawyer Goodman, Goodman Theater. They commissioned him to write a play for them. It was initially untitled, but became known as The Beauty of the Wild. And it was basically a dramatic performance about the preservation of open lands, the natural landscape, because, you know, we take for granted how much, you know, we have now in terms of parks and recreation facilities. They didn't have that back then. And so this was a performance with the native spirit, the fawn, the builder coming in who's going to ruin the landscape, the Native Americans, and so on and so forth. So it's on YouTube, actually. We have a copy of the script if you want to read it. But a few years ago, the
McLean...
if
you're willing to perform.
Yes. So.
But the McHenry County Conservation District actually pulled this play out of mothballs and actually did it as a public program. And
It's about 20 minutes long, if you can stand it.
And the language and the style of the story is very much, you know, this early 1900s period.
They would fit in nicely with the hippies of the 60s and
70s. It sounds a lot like 1960s.
So bring it on home to the Forest Preserve District. Like Chris talked about this to start, Chris has been working on this for much longer than I have, but we've had some new developments with this as well.
Yeah, so the first step, once the Downstate Forest Preserve Act was passed and actually stood and wasn't overturned by any courts or anything like that, the first step was to get it onto the ballot for the county residents to vote for it. So a petition was pulled to try to get that support. And in the 100 Stories for 100 Years blog, I think one of the earlier ones was about the petition and about the women's vote. And we provided a PDF copy of the petition, so you can actually go and see the people who signed. And that's actually still over at the county courthouse in their archives is the actual petition. Support seemed to come from a couple of different places. And in our articles, and even in earlier years, we've talked a lot about the women's role in voting for the Forest Preserve. And certainly that was very important. We're also starting to notice, as we look at the election results, Downers Grove specifically seemed to be very big and heavily involved in promoting the Forest Preserves. And women's clubs, we know, were also involved from newspaper accounts at the time. But interestingly, as we go to try to find these actual women's club records, we aren't finding a lot of mention in their scrapbooks.
So I've called probably 4 women's clubs. And actually, one thing first. If anyone has a 1915 map of DuPage County that lists the voting precincts by township, we will forever love you, because that would help us plot this out, because the voting returns show how many men and women voted for or against the creation of Forest Preserve for each township and precinct within it. I've called the Board of Elections, they laughed at me. I called the county clerk, they laughed at me. I called a few townships, they laughed at me. See a trend, but one of them also said, call one of the commissioners, I'm sure they could find it for you. And I'm like, okay. So hopefully we can find this. So if anyone knows where this might be, if you have one tucked away at home somewhere, we'd love to have it.
And the reason we're interested in this is because men and women, we always think women getting the right to vote in the 1920s, but in the state of Illinois and other states, women were sometimes granted suffrage earlier than the amendment that allowed it nationwide. But also in Illinois specifically, women were allowed to vote in specific issues. They weren't allowed to vote for certain offices, but if it was considered in the realm of a woman's sphere, like school board elections and things like that, women were not only allowed to vote, they were allowed to run for office. We actually had women serving on school boards in Wheaton back in the 1880s, 1890s. So that's something that doesn't get taught a lot in the history books about the suffrage movement,
so,
the smaller things going on. But because they were only allowed to vote on certain things, there were separate ballots printed. So they actually tabulated the votes. Here's the men's votes, here's the women's votes. So we know that if just counted the men's vote in 1915, the Forest Preserve would have narrowly lost. It was almost a 50-50 split, but just a little bit towards the no side. When you add the women's vote in there, the women voted more closer to 2-1 in favor of the Forest Preserve. So that pushed the issue over onto the victory side to get the Forest Preserve established. And they've actually got the votes tabulated out by precinct. And I would really like to map out which precincts went in favor and which went against. But what I think we would see is the rural areas tended to vote no. But they were also less populated, so their vote didn't hold as much weight. Because farmers in rural areas were preserve open space. I've got 40 acres of woodland over here, and I've got a nice stream I can go fishing in anytime I want. Why would I pay higher taxes to preserve open land for the people who live in town? So it was the people in town who were very much in favor of this. And when I mentioned Downers Grove earlier, in Downers Grove, the men and women both voted overwhelmingly in favor of it. So there seems to be kind of a hotbed of Forest Preserve support located in Downers Grove.
Where Chance Hill lives, if I'm not mistaken.
And Chance Hill lived there.
I don't think he was there. I forget
was
what year
there
he moved.
30,
yeah, he wasn't there till a little bit later.
Till 40, yeah. For sure.
Yeah. So 1940, Chance Hill gave a presentation to the Elmhurst Women's Club, what price are DuPage Forest Preserves? And in this article, and there's no mention of any of the records of the Women's Club about what he talked about specifically, but in an article after the fact, talks about how he commended local women for their involvement in creating our forest preserve. Likewise with Lombard, there's a newspaper article published this year for their 100th anniversary and saying how they were involved, but you go through their minutes, there's nothing. Same with Naperville and Downers Grove, there's nothing in their minutes or anything. But there were two articles in a scrapbook for the Lombard Women's Club in which they do mention a meeting that was sponsored by the organization. And it was about the Forest Preserve Movement in DuPage County. And they had a bunch of speakers, including Mr. Hammerschmidt and then other individuals, so F.O. Butler, who owned the land that is now Fullersburg, and then just other individuals who were active. So Colonel Plum in Lombard, who gave the land for Lalasia Park, and just a few other active individuals. Mr. Lombard also had lilacs, and so while everyone gives credit to the lilacs in Lombard being Colonel Plum, it was actually Lombard, but people don't like to talk about that. So then just looking at the first few forest preserves, the first forest preserve to be created was York Woods.
And this land was purchased in 1917. Two tracts of land bought from two different landowners that are pretty much equal in size. And an issue that's been commented on a lot lately is the issue of, Forest Preserve land being turned over for development. Well, one of the very first forest preserve actually was very quickly land was dedicated for Roosevelt Road to be built through the preserve. Interestingly, not long after that, it was actually straightened then and ran along the north edge. There's been a little bit more land dedicated for that purpose. And then if you go and look back from today's point of view, when Roosevelt Road and the York Road interchange was put in, pretty much everything from here over was given over to that bit of development as well. Since then, the Forest Preserve has added some land down here on the south end of the preserve, but if you actually look at the total acreage, today it's still a couple of acres smaller than it was back in 1917 when it was originally created before. And then this is Fogelsberg Woods, plot of land. F.O. Butler, you saw listed as one of the speakers to the women's club in support of the Forest Preserve. And he was one of the landowners that a big portion of his land actually became Forest Preserve. As we look at the development of the preserves, once we've been established, now it's a matter of getting land and turning it into park space. And the theory of park design that we see from these early landscape architects is something that Chance Hill had learned and was implemented. And one of those basic views was that, yes, we want to preserve natural areas and preserve scenic beauty, but we also want to make it a place for the public to enjoy. And so as part of that, they were willing to do some pretty radical alterations to what the area looked like. And I like this landscape plan drawn by Chance Hill. And what I like about this one is, you look up here on the north end, between the island and the main part, you can actually see a thinner lined area that says present stream. The area beyond those lines is what the Civilian Conservation Corps dredged out to create areas for boating and skating. And if you follow that, you can see how wide this would not have been part of Salt Creek when the Civilian Conservation Corps started there. They dredged all of that out. And the same down here, the original stream bed is just right here. And they dredged all this out. The islands were created to give that place where people could cross bridges and they could boat around in lagoons and enjoy.
So to recreate the picturesque.
Yep. So they were enhancing nature to make it a little more enjoyable for the public.
And likewise with McDowell, another plan also drawn by Hill, showing the islands and then the picnic grounds. And the parking lot originally for McDowell was on the other side of that bridge before you head over it. And so people would have to walk into the preserve, walk into the picnic groves. You couldn't just park and go right to the shelter. You had to, take everything from the car and walk all the way in. Again, just the separation between society and nature.
So here's your original parking area for McDowell Grove. So the only bridge in was actually a footbridge that's no longer there. It's an arched footbridge that would bring a visitor into the preserves.
And another.
This is the Warrenville Grove Dam that the Civilian Conservation Corps built.
So to replace the brick, stone one. So a few other interesting things we found in the early history of the Forest Preserve. Arboretum or Preserve, in reading the last big county history book that was written in the 80s, talks about the Morton Arboretum, Joy Morton, and he was considering apparently donating his land to the Forest Preserve District. However, it says in there, and this comes from an interview that was done with Winnock shortly before he passed away, we're still trying to find it. But he advised Morton not to donate his land to the district. He didn't want it to get held up in political vagrancies. And so, well, that may be true. I also speculate in looking at this and looking at the, prairie-style landscape architecture, that due to the non-native trees that Morton was putting in, not to diminish what he was doing, but because of that, I'm thinking if we did receive the land at some point, we would have taken out a lot of those specimens so that we could restore the natural prairies and wetlands and all of that. Also, side note, Win Knock also advised Robert McCormick on the creation of his estate, so preserving the Cantini estate as well. So just another interesting tidbit.
Another interesting tidbit is he is my grandfather.
Win Knock?
Really? So if you have that tape at home somewhere.
Research.
So just to finish up with a little bit on Chance Hill, a little more detail. So he started off as a student, like all of us did, and he was learning from the greats. He then went on to become a teacher and taught future landscape architects. One thing I do want to look into is who he taught, what his students went on to do. He taught classes, everything from design, construction, to the office practice in landscape gardening. And he was also a special lecturer on special topics. When he was a student, he did a civic design course, and him and his classmates over 2 years put together analysis of Champaign-Urbana. He also did a proposed plan for the golf course at U of I. He also took a class in cemetery design. So they were doing a little bit of everything. And this is right when the program was started, is right in that time after Hill graduated that there was actually a landscape architecture program. And I believe it was this past year they celebrated their 100th anniversary. And then just practitioner, you know, working alongside a lot of these individuals we've talked about. He was in, you know, Friends of our Native Landscape with Wilhelm Miller, one of his professors. But one thing that, you know, I found is that he was forgotten. When I was originally hired on, Chris sent me a list of projects I'd be working on, and I was like, oh great, I'm going to be looking into Chance Hill. Who the heck is that? I know Jens Jensen, but I don't know who he is. And, I mean, as a historian, I like the challenge. I enjoy learning new topics, but at first I was like, really? This is what I'm going to be doing? But it's just been interesting to see just how much there is about him out there when you look, but all the big organizations don't know anything about him. University of Illinois, nothing. The department, they have a few of his drawings, and there's an article from the Daily Illini in 1940s where Hill donated a lot of his works and had them displayed, including the plan, I want to say it's for Churchill. And yeah, no idea where those are now. So just to, you know, bring him to light and to show the work he did. He was even a fellow for the American Society of Landscape Architects, and they have in their files that he was a fellow, but they know absolutely nothing about him. So one thing with all this research, it's turned into, I call an archive for help and trying to find something, and they send me to someone else, and I end up helping them and having to send them stuff. So I was corresponding with a professor at Ball State University who sent me an image of a plan he did for a residence in Monticello, Illinois. He wrote a book about prairie-style architecture in Illinois. He's working on a book on Indiana. Hill did two parks in Indiana and a residence. So he asked where I found that, and the Society of Landscape Architects is like, can you send us information so that they can put a biography of Chance Hill on their website? So that'll be one of the lasting things from all this work. But more importantly, you know, in our own backyard, he was our landscape architect from the 20s to 40s, involved with the CCC camps, Fullersburg and McDowell, and overseeing work in Herrick Lake, Warrenville Grove, Churchill Woods, West DuPage Woods, Pioneer Park, Burlington Park, York Woods, and Rocky Glen. So very impressive for the time, you know, all the work that he did for the district while he was still doing other work around the country, I mean around Illinois. So where are we going next? A few other things we've been looking at in
Brian's
later
got
history.
Brian's got 2 weeks left in his summer time here, so he's got to do all
I started writing blog posts today. I think I'm going to try and do 5 for you guys. Maybe more. We'll see how much I get done. I wrote half of 2 of them today. But looking in the Illinois Prairie Path, I've been coming to Kim Butler. This is Kim Butler. She's the archivist at North Central College, my alma mater. And so I've been doing a lot of work with her trying to find out 2 things. If any relations between the Illinois Prairie Path and the Forest Preserve. And one interesting thing we found is this bridge. And they wrote like pages and pages about this bridge in the 70s, just south of Churchill Woods, crossing the river. And there have been a total of 5 bridges in the span of about 10 years, I think it is. And the first bridge they put in, and this is the Illinois Prairie Path, they're funded, they're getting the supplies, doing the work. They put in a bridge. That one was damaged and vandalized. They put in a second bridge. Well, the DuPage River flooded, one of the 100-year floods, and washed it down the river, and the Forest Preserve came in and brought it back up the river, put it back into place, only to have it washed away a few days later. The Prairie Path got the supplies to build another bridge. The Forest Preserve put in a third one. That one was there for 5 years. It was vandalized. I believe that was one of the arson bridges. And so we put in another bridge that was there for 10 whole days before it was burned again. And so the Forest Preserve did not put in the 5th one. I believe the 5th one was a metal bridge.
The 70s were a wild time.
And the other thing we've been looking into is the barracks that were at Camp McDowell. There were 9 army-style barracks there. And they were used there from the time the camp was created through the time that the radar school and all that closed in 46 and everything was sold off. 1946, early 47 was also when North Central College, with the GI Bill, they're trying to accommodate more students. They brought on 9 Army style barracks. We don't know where they came from. We heard from one person that, they were moved from McDowell to North Central. It's entirely possible given the connection between the Forest Preserve and the college. Chance Hill also, as I said, did a landscape plan for part of the campus at North Central, same time that he was here. And also in work, kind of like work study programs, we had people that were recruited from the college to be a assistant to the director of the Forest Preserve for a semester, and then for the OSS camp and all that, they were recruiting out of the college to get people to come out there. So there's a connection there. We haven't been able to prove it, but it seems plausible that the barracks that were at McDowell went to North Central. So we're trying to track that down. Haven't had any luck yet. And then we're also looking into the Hidden Lake Bridge that needs to be replaced, and whether it's historical significance. We believe it to be one of the oldest bridges in DuPage County, if not the oldest bridge. It was built by, we think, King's Bridges. They were out of Cleveland, Ohio, and they did bridges across the country. And we believe it to be one of their early bridges. It's mentioned, we don't know if it's this bridge or an earlier bridge, when the mill was there in Hidden Lake, Barney's Mill. And so mentions of crossing over that bridge in reference to where the mill is, and then for people like Joy Morton and Yackley going into Bonaparte, one of the early settlements, just to north of Butterfield. Actually, one of the buildings, one of the schools is still there, the intersection of Park and Butterfield on the northwest side. So it's very plausible this is the bridge they're talking about in those accounts. So we're trying to trace down pictures and more information about it. We found a few, and so we're trying to track down where those came from.
Yeah, and the style of the bridge very much matches King Iron Bridge Company, which was out of Cleveland, Ohio. And the style, specifically the style of the bridge, matches one of their early patents for their bridges. So we're probably looking at 18, and I think even the engineering study that was done on the bridges hit this around the same time period, late 1800s, or late mid-1800s, 1860s, maybe the 1880s is when this bridge dates to.
And we will put these photos on the Common Drive. We would really, if you can pass these around, especially people who would have been working for the district in the 70s, we'd love to identify the workers in these photos, and so you can zoom in on them, and hopefully we can identify them. It'd be a great way for us to do an oral history with them, see if they remember anything from this, or they're just in general their time with the district. And just very briefly to sum up, all the research we've been doing, it doesn't go to waste. Helps, expand the knowledge of our cultural history that the vision for the district talks about, and then just community engagement. So doing talks like this. Last night, Chris and I gave a talk to the Trail Patrol. We had 35 people here. Gave the same presentation. Chris is going in October to the Elmhurst Garden Club, mm-hmm. And they expect 60 to 70 people. So these talks will continue. And we're also planning to do a blog post for the Centennial blog, and maybe I'll turn into a conservationist article. And then just building relationships with other institutions, other museums and archives in the county. So North Central College, the DuPage County Historical Museum, going out to Indiana. And then so just building the institutional memory of the district and the land. So
and it keeps a couple of history geeks very entertained. So
Chris has been a kid in a candy shop because he has someone who he can talk history with and doesn't just look at him like.
And I like all the nature people too, but that's right.
So thanks everyone for coming. If you have any questions, we're happy to answer them about any of the other research we've been doing or anything we talked about today.
The Prairie Club of Chicago was very active in saving the Indiana Dunes and getting it put aside and preserved from development. And so when the Prairie Club, which still exists, was looking for... What's that?
Harbard, Indiana, that's where the Prairie Club is?
That might, I thought they had a branch, at least in here locally, in Lombard.
Somewhere. That's where they're based now, but they do have a few camps still. Hazelhurst, and then I forget the second one.
Yeah, there's a second one. But when they decided to give all of their archives to the institution to preserve them, they chose one close to the dunes because that was, they were so involved in that. And Jensen designed a fountain that was dedicated there in the early years of the dunes. And great photos of them out there in their, doing their little plays and dances on the beach with togas and the 1920s.
So yeah, if anyone ever wants to recreate it, we're going for it.
Toga. No, so it was a very, very interesting group. And they were so good about copying everything for us and granting us permissions to use them in publications. We'll be able to history pin these photos onto the district's history.
The goal of for them is to have everything digitized, have it out there, have it used. So as long as we cite it, we have all the rights to do whatever we want.
Yeah, they were very generous. Not all archives are quite that generous, but they were very good at wanting their history shared. So.
But Kim's great too, so if you ever need anything.
Yes.
I know there was a recent social media post, something about, you know, not 100 stories we've been talking about. I think it was in the mid-late 60s, there was our largest acquisition of land, I think, from a referendum. Is there a reason why that was so supported in the 60s? You know, was there anything going on in this area that it just...
We haven't actually looked into that directly, but I would think a part of it would be DuPage County really started zooming into development post-World War II. And in the couple of decades right after that. So there would have been a lot of what people saw around them and remembered as being open space or farmland was being, you know, sold off and subdivided and developed very quickly. And then also you're starting to get towards the very start of the whole ecology movement of the late 60s, early 70s. So so that movement was going strong as well. So
thank you.
So that's just a hunch. I would need to authenticate that, but that's, you know, that would be probably two very important factors.
I'm curious, you were talking earlier about the distance that the people were traveling. And in my mind as a historian, I'm thinking, well, like you mentioned, these people are coming from Chicago where you got the slaughterhouse next door and, you know, you've got the toll house and then you've got work in the factory. And so you're willing to make that hike. And today people don't really realize, well, like when they visit Fuller's Road, why are all these pavilions so far away? Why do we have to hike all the way out here? Well, back then, people, that was part of the experience because they didn't have that. I mean, everything was, when you think about city life, it was all right in front of you. So that, they went out of their way for that experience, for that walk.
Mm-hmm.
What I'm curious, I guess, is if you guys would be able to estimate roughly how far we're talking about from the train depot, maybe in, I could imagine in Hinsdale it might not have been so far to Fullersburg, but what type of distances are we talking about? Could this be done in a day, these types of walks?
Most of these were day hikes. They actually say Saturday afternoon walks, although I have a feeling, given the fact that they would say we're going to stop here for lunch, we were talking mostly pretty much all day hikes.
Right.
For
well, and in the booklets they do have the train that they were taking, what time it got into the station, and then what time they were going to be at the other station to leave and go back in the city. Most of them got in here, you know, the area, wherever they were going, between 10:30 and noon, and they were back on a 5 or 6 o'clock train. So they were hoofing it.
Yeah, that would be one to figure out, but given the time and the distance, what would be the miles per hour that they were walking. They would have filled up their 100-mile challenge thing pretty quickly, just a few walks. But just going back to the idea of the people involved and the, you know, the people living near the stockyards, I do get a hint from what we see and the fact that they did charge for these hikes and there's the cost of the train excursion and that kind of stuff. These were actually probably your more affluent Chicagoans, middle to upper class, not the folks that were living in the back of the yards.
Not right off the boat, barely speaking.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. And those were probably the people then that were voting to preserve open space and, you know, who were actually registered to vote and did vote in the time frame.
And the Chicago, Burlington, and Northern, Quincy, CB&Q would stop in Naperville at Burlington Park, one of our forest reserves, and it would be a scheduled stop right there, and the river was also dammed there to create a boating area. And there was a grandstand for baseball. They had like elk, you know, deer there. and it was a definite destination, and it lasted until about 1910 when the locals were like finding the riffraff was getting a little too, you know, active, and that stopped. But the forest reserves really have played a great role in
it. Burlington Park's got a neat history, and again, that idea of using what we consider now DuPage County, they thought of it as the excursion. This was getting away from the city. And so, yeah, Burlington made money off of excursion trains. Big groups of 500-600 people would come out and do two-day events out there, camp out. And yeah, well, really, really cool. We just got a bunch of photos from the Napier Settlement Archives that we're going to be able to history pin of Burlington Park, actually, of people sitting in the grass. And I think we've used them in some publications before, too, some of the same photos.
I mean, that just goes to show just too how all the suburbs developed. You know, we had suburbs that were, you know, commuter suburbs, so people were coming in and out of the city. You had the suburbs where, you know, the doctors and the lawyers of Chicago were living. So Elmhurst in Hinsdale, that's, you know, where they were living. And then you had the places that were destinations and so on and so forth. So each of the suburbs in DuPage County developed for a different reason. So that's also just an interesting way to, you know, tie in, you know, the recreational use and, you know, the place to live outside the city and then just to be a commuter. So just something else to keep in mind.
Any other questions?
What's the origin on the state statute, or do you know anything about the downstate forest preserve?
Yeah, that was pushed by these folks in Chicago to get that passed so that each county could create forest preserves. So they were kind of working on two parallel lines. They were trying to create a state park system, and then they were also trying to pass this law to get so counties could create.
What do they call it, downstate?
That's what I'm going.
Yeah, I don't know.
No
I've
idea.
Not come across why they call it downstate. Because Chicago was the first.
Because the Cook County had their own. There was the Cook County Forest Preserve District Act. And then downstate was everybody else.
Okay. Well, how about Lake and McHenry?
Yeah.
Well, then they were all created under the Downstate Forest Preserve Act. Yeah. Those are us and those other ones. But then Cook County eventually was as well. So, because as soon as the Downstate Forest Preserve Act was passed, the modern Cook County Forest Preserve is organized under that law. So, but yeah, you're right. They did have a forest district prior to the Downstate Forest Preserve Act being passed. And I'm sure Jensen was probably heavily involved in that as well.
It may just speak subtly, although not so subtly, to literally the political divide, mental divide, between Cook County
and everybody else.
Mm-hmm. I mean, we make fun of it, but it's right there in that word, which, mm-hmm. you know, Tom and I are thinking alike here. We're only talking about a mile away, and that all of a sudden became downstate because it crossed the county line.
Crossed the county line.
But that speaks volumes of the political mindset.
If you go far enough south and you look at the history, you go back into the Civil War. Now, when the governor of Illinois at the time said we need so many troops to support Lincoln's war, some of the troops signed up and went south, fought for the Confederacy. Mm-hmm. So, and that was true in all the way, you could probably go to the center of the state. So the mindset, the division, was even farther north at one point.
Right,
so
and cultural,
right.
In addition to being political.
Well, absolutely. Too, if you look at the, you know, Daniel Burnham's plan for Chicago, he defines the Chicagoland area as 60-mile ring around the city. So anything that wasn't that was just Illinois, the other, so.
Yeah,
yeah,
Illinois was
perpetuating that
was
divide.
Settled from the bottom up.
It was, yeah, the first settlements were down along the river.